Welcome to the NMAA Podcast, the best basketball league in Orlando and the longest running Muslim sports league in America. Based out of sunny Orlando in Florida, featuring weekly game previews, player stats, heated rivalries, and guest stars. Now, your hosts, Waaris, Zaheer, the coach, Omer Zahid, the Don, Dev Lachman. Take it away, fellas.
What's going on, NMAA family? We are back with another edition of the podcast. I am your host, Waaris Zaheer, and I am joined for the first time this season by Captain Kareem Moslehy. How are you doing, my brother?
Assalamu alaikum, man. Waaris, it feels good to be back. I know it's been a long time, first time this season. And I want to say, man, like even towards the end of last season, it was tough for me to, you know, to get on here. So it's good to join you on the podcast. And yeah, man, let's do this.
Hey, you know, we appreciate you coming on. We know you appreciate you making your, I will say from my perspective, I appreciate you making your time to come on and
let's
get on the podcast, especially after what happened this week. And you know what? Yeah. I will take the Band-Aid off quickly. Al Wahoosh versus this is the wrong week. What am I doing?
Hold we're on. Off to a great start.
Great start.
We're a little rusty. Right. Hey, it's been a little bit, Waaris. We're a little rusty.
Fighters E versus Mutaqeen. And that wasn't on purpose, bro. I promise you. I wasn't trying to show you both your losses back to back. I'm sorry. Fighter Z versus Mutaqeen, 57-51. Fighter Z in overtime. And overtime losses, Kareem. Come on, man. Two in a row. Man. Sucks. Yeah, but for the box score, Chris Roman, 20 points, 20 rebounds, 2 blocks, 2 assists. Hadas Javid, 11 points, 3 to end it. DJ Tony was kept in check, 9 points. 3 rebounds. Kaz had 8 points, 5 rebounds. Ibrahim with 5 points, 2 rebounds, 2 assists. Kwong Pham, 8 rebounds, 6 assists, but only 4 points. Okay, stat line there. Mutaqeen, BG, 14 points, 6 rebounds, 5 assists, 3 steals. Byron Martinez, 9 points, 10 rebounds, 3 assists, and 1 steal. Yusuf Khan with 9 points, 3 threes. Fatullah, 6 points. Kareem, you had 5, 4, and 3 assists and a steal. Mobeen with 4, Mohsen with 2, and Izzy Isidore with 2 points. So your whole team scored there. But talk me through this game, man. I didn't watch any of it because I was on the other side, but talk me through it.
Oh, man. It was a tough game. I'm not going to lie, man. Fighters, they played as well. I felt like they had a good game plan. In you know, playing a 2-3 zone defense with you know focus on me and BG not getting looks, you would think it'd be counterintuitive to go 2-3 when you're trying to stop shooters, but they managed to do it. I really struggled to get looks in this game. And BG only had 14 points, so defensively, I thought you know Fighters had one of their, like their better games this season. But at the same time, too, like anybody who plays us, right? It's such a low scoring game. So is it, you know, is it just like, you know, is it their defensive, you know, presence or like all our games just sloppy in general or, yeah. you know, just kind of, you know, rough games in general. But, yeah, man, we really didn't get going. I think we were down the whole game until the fourth quarter when we took like our first lead was, I think, like probably 3 minutes to go in the fourth. Mm-hmm. The whole game where, you know, we're fighting back. Yeah, they definitely had a double-digit lead, you know, as late as like some point during the third quarter, and then during the fourth quarter, they had a lead as big as 9 points with 10 to go. And so, yeah, we really didn't get going until we got it. You know, got a few threes from Yusuf, got a run going, and then
Yusuf really is that spark plug, man. Shout out to Yusuf.
Oh, we needed him, man. He was quiet for most of the game there until he hit 2 big threes to equalize the game there. But yeah, man, it's tough, man, to have the game in your hands. Like we had the game in our hands there. Again, we were up 2 with like you know a minute and a half to go. And then Hadas hit a big 3. you know, on a play that like I would literally pull my hair out on because, you know, we somehow we managed to lose him, right? Or not stay close enough to him. And I sit here, Waaris, man, if you see my chats, man, the amount of writing that I do, I'm like, all right, hey, this is everything that like all of these players, these are the scouting reports for every one of these players. I'll go through, put videos breaking down what they do, how they like to score. Did all of that, and with Hottis, you know it. Like, do not give him any space, even sniper, if he's bro. Freaking 30 feet out. You stay on him. And it came down to two late threes from Hottis, one to put him up late in the game, and then obviously the game winner. So props to those guys, man. They played us tough, and another overtime loss. My guys are bummed here, so I'm trying to pick them up and let them know that, hey, it's two losses, two close losses that I feel like we could have won. I felt like it was on us that we lost those two games.
Yeah, I mean, even Hottis, shout out to Hottis, by the way, who after he hit the three, walks over to the camera. He goes, "That's what I do."
That's what I do.
Like, oh, Hottis pumped up. I love it.
I mean, he's not lying, man. He's not lying.
Yeah, yeah. I think his best game to date. I think he's been kind of off this season. We were talking about how the ups and downs of trying to coach and be consistent as a player can be tough. So for him to have those two big threes in the fourth and overtime, that's huge for them. But at the same time, I don't think this is like a huge indictment on what Mutaqeen and what you guys do. I think it's more of, hey, man, the league is not. You're not running through teams. Like, nobody's – well, we'll have another game this week that I have to talk about. But most of the time, you're not running through teams. It's close matchups. It's the little margins where you get your wins, where you get your losses. So small things like a technical foul or a bad turnover or something small like that can seem like insignificant to the person that did it. But
big time.
Huge in terms of momentum. Implication, and game shifting.
Yeah. It's semi-pro. It all matters, man. And it's stuff I'm telling my guys, too. We had three
That's missed the beauty of it.
Yeah, we had three missed free throws in the fourth quarter. We had three turnovers in the fourth quarter in overtime, one in overtime. Like, that, those are costly. Everything, every possession, every point matters. You know, it's all about level of focus, try to minimize your mental lapses, mm-hmm. whether it's on offense, on defense. I feel like at times, man, like you've got to, you know, give enough effort and focus in the first quarter, because you don't wanna go back at the end of the game and you're just like, damn, all right, like that. Like you said, that technical foul in the first quarter, man, like that's 2 points in the ball back, and they scored on that possession. Imagine, you know, hey, having those 4 points back. You know, stuff like
that. Yeah, man. Yeah, for sure. But Mutaqeen, obviously, still contenders. Fighter Z, a strong contending and big bounce back win for them after their loss the week before. But this game was not as close. Blessed versus Al-Aqsa. Blessed 67, Al-Aqsa 37. For Blessed, 17 points, 12 rebounds, 2 assists, a block, and a steal for Amir Zafari. Tony Koo, 17 points, 5 rebounds, hit 5 threes. Khalid with 16 points, hit 3 threes himself. Brian Brown, 10 points, 4 rebounds, 6 assists, 2 steals. Ahmed El-Shari with 5 points and 3 rebounds. Hamza got on the board with 2 points. I'll say it with zero. Come on, I'll say it. Al-Aqsa, same old story, unfortunately. Chris Ross, 12.6 rebounds. Muhammad Hare with 12 points, 11 rebounds. Nader with 10, 4, and 5 assists. Bilal hit a 3. But this game got ugly, and it got ugly quickly.
Yeah.
If you see here, I can share this tab. It was 26-11 in the first quarter, and then 15-6 in the second quarter, and then 19-9 in the third quarter, and then in the last quarter, yikes, they kind of just coasted after the game was already over. So, yes, it got ugly quick. It stayed ugly. Blessed defense came out, and they were stifling Al-Aqsa. They couldn't get a look off. It was all turnovers. I think it was the start, it was like, I looked over, it was 20-something to 6. I want to say 24-6, something like that.
Yep.
To start. And after that, it was just bless off the races. Shout out to Ramsey, who put a lot of his end of the bench guys in towards the end of the game and just let them play out the rest of the game, because
it was over
by the second quarter. And I jokingly told Jeff in the second quarter, it was like a 37 point game. And you know how when there's like 45 seconds left, it's like a 12 point game, and then the team's not fouling, the refs will just call it early. I was like, Jeff, just call this one, bro.
It's like, what are you doing, Jeff?
It's just a wrap. It's a wrap. They were up by more in the third quarter than what Al-Aqsa even scored.
Yikes.
So, Al-Aqsa eventually cut it a little bit to where they were not getting doubled up. But a very terrible showing for Al-Aqsa, who, when we played them week one, I thought there'd be a contender, have nosedived off the face of the planet. And no disrespect to Blessed, obviously, all credit to Blessed for coming out and doing what, you know, they're supposed to do. And I don't know if 30 point win is what they're supposed to do. They put it on them, right?
Big time.
But I feel like any team in the league should not be losing by 30 and be down 20 plus for all four quarters.
Yeah.
So, Al-Aqsa has some stuff to figure out, Kareem. What do you think?
Yeah, that's unacceptable, especially, you know, when you go down that big that early. I mean, where's your fight? Where's your heart? Right? If things start getting out of control, which they did, I mean, it appeared to be a 3-point barrage by Blessed. I was doing stats in the other game, but every time I looked up, somebody was shooting and hitting a three. You've got to adjust quicker, and I feel like that's an area where Muhammad Harry, right? He's got to, hey, call your timeouts and make your adjustment like right away. Like, you know, I don't care if you have a game plan that, you know, you got everybody on board with, and you got to bin it, you know, within the first few minutes. Do what you need to do, right? If it's getting that ugly that quickly, you know, adjust quick. And they didn't do that, man. And like you said, man, like if you're going to be down that much, right? Like it's tough to look at the scoreboard and, you know, try to play as if it's 0-0. But at the same time too, like you don't want it to appear like you've given up, right? Like, you know, fight with what you got, right? Try to salvage anything that you can out of it. And right, just don't kind of lay over and take it. That's just not a good look, man. So it was rough to see Al-Aqsa do that, man. But credit to Bless, man. I mean, this is a really dangerous team, and if you don't get control of them quickly, like they will go for the kill, you know, right away. I mean, first quarter, they're going for the kill. So like you gotta meet them and you know, take their first punch. Get back up and you know, punch back. What's crazy is that you know, all the double digit wins this season, there wasn't any team that scored or that won by a deficit of 20 or more, except for Blessed 2 times. In those games, 30 this weekend against Al-Aqsa and 42 against Al-Qamar. No other team has won in double digits, you know, with a point differential greater than 20 points in a game. So just goes to show you, man. Like, if they get going, you better slow them down.
42.
Yeah, crazy.
This one could have been worse too. They let off the gas. You know what I mean? Like, man. Yeah, Blessed. If they get it clicking, and if they stay clicking, they're gonna be pretty tough to beat. I don't know how. If you'd have to really stop a lot of things for it to go right. But speaking of being unstoppable, Kareem, you did stats for this game. I'll let you talk about it, but I'm going to go to the box score first. Black Mamba's 3-game win streak after the 11-game losing streak. Ozzy putting it on us. 65-57. Al-Qamar loses to the Black Mambas. Derek Dangerfield with 20 points, 6 assists. Juan Ayala with 13, 6 and 2. Isaiah with 9 points, 3 rebounds. Nick Tuhi with 7 and 4. But I will not bury the lead here. Black Mambas, maybe the stat line on semi-pro history. 32 points and 26 rebounds for Ahmed Fellow, and 32 on 0 made threes and 0 attempted threes. 32. This man brought it back to Wilt Chamberlain stat lines, bro.
What 32
and 26? But aside from him, Eli, 17 points. David Roman, new addition, 6 points. Ahmed Elgendi with 12 rebounds, 4 steals, and 4 points himself. But 32 and 26. Kareem, talk to me about this game.
I mean, Fellow is on another level right now. I don't know what you can do to really stop him, right? You could game plan around, all right, hey, everybody's boxing him out. As soon as the shot goes up, like, you're not even looking at the rim. You're not looking at the ball. You're turning and facing him, and he's still going to find a way to get rebounds. This guy is the heart. He's the motor of this team, and, you know, he's putting them on his back. And, Fellow has made me a believer. You know, like, I really regret not drafting him this season. Yeah, I needed a big, and, you know, I hesitated, right, to draft Fellow, and I regret it. And the guy's killing it. And like you said, 32 points, 26 rebounds may indeed be the stat line in our 5 or 6 seasons of NMIA semi-pro. I want to say Debo had a game where he had like 25 plus rebounds. I think I remember that. But 32 and 26?
Insanity.
On no threes. He shot 5 free throws, hit 4 of them. And I was doing stats for this game, and I kid you not, Waaris, I mean, like, me and you were doing it in the first half.
Me and you were standing there,
Yeah. I could not pick up my head from the laptop. I'm like, because you're calling him out, you're like, rebound, fellow, 2 points, fellow. And I can't even, like, look up to see, like, what's happening. And everything was just, everything, involved Fellow. It was crazy.
It literally became a joke at one point where you had not looked up because you were catching up to the last possession where he got a rebound.
Yep.
And I'm like, okay, steal them. Rebound Fellow.
Yeah.
Rebound Fellow, 2 points Fellow.
2 points Fellow.
and you're not looking. And then you're just like, what? Why? So I'm like, no. That's, he got another rebound after that. Then you were like, okay. Then I'm like, yeah, 3 points, Derek. Okay, rebound Fellow, put back Fellow, 2 points Fellow.
Dude, you were like, I could not keep up. It was the hardest.
You're like drowning putting the stats in.
Dude, it was the hardest stat job I've ever had to do, man. It was crazy. But yeah, no, Black Mamas, man, they look good, man. That's 3 wins in a row from them. Credit to Ozzy, credit to Gindy for getting the best out of this group right now. Eli showed up late in this game, but they were still hanging in there. I want to say for a good portion of the game, Mamba's was up. And every time that it looked like they were going to pull away, Hummel kind of fought back. Derek was really, he was keeping him in the game. I mean, 6 threes from Derek is killer. I mean, he was doing everything for them. He was shooting the ball well. The way that he was able to, facilitate and play make too, like he was their best player on Sunday, and they kept calling back. But every time that it got close, every time when we were like, hey, this is going to be, a good finish, Mamba's would just pull away. And it's got to be because of a couple times when Ozzy would just snap on his team. You just call timeout. And obviously we'll keep it PG rated. But man, he would go in, like, I'm talking about, like, in on Gindy, like his co-captain, right, was going in on him. And then right out of that timeout, they would just bump up the lead back up to 6, 7, 8 points. And they look good. I like Mamba's. I like the heart that they're showing, right? Yeah. In their ability to just all play the roles that they need to play. And we'll see, man. It's going to be a dangerous team in the playoffs for sure.
Yeah, for sure. It's going to be tough to stop. And what's crazy is there's been, in the last 4 games, right, Fellow has had 23 rebounds, 21 rebounds, 26 rebounds, and 11 against us. So now I'm like, when he had 11 first, I was like, man, we got to keep him in single digits, but now I'm like, maybe 11 was a great job that we did, because he's got 20 plus every single game. It's getting crazy. So, and at one point, their offense was literally just throw it anywhere towards the rim, and Fellow will get the rebound.
Let him go get it.
It was insane.
It's crazy. And like, now he's developed this nice touch around the rim now, like where he'll get the ball, like, and he'll take contact, but still kind of just like softly put it up on the rim, almost like Jokic-esque, right? Yeah. Where it's just such a soft touch, it manages to go in. And that's what's killer. I think that's what's different about him this season, is that he's, you know, he's converting all those second chances that he, you know, has always been generating and creating, but he's just converting them now into two points.
Yeah, he's been great. He's been great so far. I think very strong consideration for at least an MVP nomination, if not some votes too.
I agree, man. Real quick, you know what's crazy is that Chris Roman is still leading the league in rebounds, 17 rebounds per game, which is an absurd number, and then fell at 15.5. I don't know. How is that possible? What's going on here?
Wait. Oh, wow. I mean, he had 20 rebounds himself, so let's
he
not.
Did. Like, he killed us on the boards.
But. He's not a slouch. So, last game, but definitely not least, Al-Wahoosh versus Nars.
Ooh, buddy.
Crazy game. Nars pulls out the win, 64-61. Wahoosh, for Wahoosh, Arib, 23 points. Arib is so hard to stop, man. 23 points, 9 rebounds, 2 assists, and a steal. Sharif Robinson, 12 points. 4 rebounds, 2 assists. Carlos Roman, 8 points. Got hurt in the middle of this game. Alex McCord with 6 points, 5 rebounds. Prince with 6 points as well and 7 rebounds himself. For Nars, Marcus Ford, 28 points, 12 rebounds, 2 assists, 1 huge assist right at the end, and 1 block. Jamal, 14 points, 5 rebounds, 3 steals. I had 10 points, 7 rebounds, 3 assists, 2 steals, and a block. Dev with 7, 6, and 3, but the story of the game right here, Hamad Zaidi, and this is all you need to know.
That's crazy.
This little 3 points, his 3-point shot that he hit right at the end. But let me, you know, weave the story a little bit. And this game was a little back and forth. The whole first half was back and forth. But then there was one possession where Jamal got fouled. They didn't think it was a foul. I believe Prince like slammed the ball on the ground, which is an automatic technical. So Jamal gets the 2 free throws, gets the tech, hits both those free throws, goes 4 for 4. And then they're like scrambling, like, wait, why is he shooting 4 free throws? And they're arguing with the ref. While they're arguing with the ref, they hand the ball in. Then they're trying to scramble back on defense. I'm open for 3. I hit a 3, and they call a timeout. We go on a 7-0 run on one possession.
That's a backbreaker.
And suddenly, from going down 1, we're now up 6. And we kind of take the lead. In the third quarter, they go on a run where Arib and Sharif are finishing all in the paint. All over. I'm like, dude, I'm trying to stop. Arib is a dog, man. This guy is hard to stop. And he has these little like jerky moves when he gets to the paint where he'll catch me and I'll kind of jump and contest and miss him. But at the end, we're down 6. I hit a 3 to cut it to 3. Marcus hits a 2. And then Jamal hits a super clutch 3. I don't think he took a jump shot the whole game besides that one. Maybe it was his second.
You kind of cringe. You kind of cringe when that shot went up, man. I was looking at you.
Because you know what? I was like, and I'm okay with him shooting in general, but I'm like, he has to be ice cold. There's no, because he hasn't shot a single shot. We were using him as a dunker spot, so we were dropping him off. He was getting layups, but. Uh-huh. I'm like, he hasn't definitely not shot a 3. Maybe he shot a jump shot, but definitely. So I'm like, swing it, Jamal, swing it. And he's jabbing. He's looking at a defender. He jabbed like 5 times.
He kept jabbing.
I'm like, Jamal, swing it. Swing, swing. And he puts it up and I'm like, oh God. I'm like, he shot it. Swish. And I'm like, so like concerned like, of the fact that he even shot it. That it didn't even register that, oh my God, he just hit it. We just took the lead. Let me go play defense. I was just like, you shot it, bro. Come on, man. But he hit it. We go up 2. They get some free throws. They get 4 free throws. I believe they hit 3 out of 4. So they tie the game with 6 seconds left. Dev draws up a play because Sid's actually out of town. So Dev was coaching us while playing. Dev draws up a play, hand it to Marcus. Marcus drives, gets almost quadruple teamed. No way he can put it up. kicks it to the corner. Hamad has just subbed in and has maybe taken one shot the whole game. And Hamad catches it and he's wide open. And he puts it up. And as he shoots it, I was like, that is cash.
Yeah, yeah.
I put both of my hands up and I start running towards him like, we just won this game. Swishes it at the buzzer and I lose my mind. I'm picking him up. Like, come on, let's go. And then, just a buzzer beating game winner. I was talking to Ramsey about this. I don't know if we've ever had a buzzer beating game winner. Have we, Kareem? Do you remember one off the top of your head?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I don't remember like a specific, like I can't tell you like what game or what season it was, but I want to say like there's been at least one in semi-pro for sure.
Oh, okay. Well, yeah. I was trying to, me and him were kind of spitballing like maybe BG got one. I remember BG hitting like a huge clutch shot at the buzzer, but it might've been the fourth overtime. I don't know. But right. One of the only game winners at the buzzer ever. At the most, it's probably like two or three. And that was the second or third one. So Hamad with the clutch gene held loved the gooseneck
it.
Up.
I loved it. One of my favorite things about basketball, watching basketball games, right, is to see everybody's reaction when a game winner happens. And yours was the best, Waaris. Like for you to just like run up there, grab this guy, bear hug him. Like you should probably check in on him and like if his back or if his, you know what I'm saying, like his ribs are okay. Yeah. But just seeing everybody just like storm the court and then like Ozzy's on the camera. He's like, get off the court.
We were on the other like, court. We didn't even know how the game was in overtime.
Yeah, you guys are spilling into my game. I'm like, what the hell just happened? We're in a close game of our own. I love watching back, you know, just everybody's reactions and stuff like that. And that was a great play by Dev. I think you had the options there, right? Like getting Marcus going downhill. Using you for those handoffs just makes all the sense in the world because whoever's chasing the person who's going to get that ball off that handoff, like that's a big person to run around and chase.
Solar eclipse. Yeah.
Right. And then you get Marcus going downhill, right? And you give him the options, right? Like, hey, if they don't, you know, crash, all right, you go straight to the rim. All right. Marcus can finish that, right? If anything, he can draw a foul. If they collapse on you, you kick it out. And now you got, you know, shooters on your team, right? You know, once Sid comes back, you know, you've got Sid, Hamad, now Theron can shoot, you can shoot, right? So these driving kicks, you know, can be there. So I don't know. It was the right play to make. And obviously you have to make the shot. So shout out to Hamad, man. That was a great play. Tough for a host to lose like that. But hey, man, that's what makes basketball great here.
Yeah, that was a battle. It was a battle for sure. I'm happy now that we got our third win. I think we're kind of secure in the fact that we'll at least be a 6, 7, or 8 seed. Obviously, that's not the high aspirations, but you do like to get to that threshold of, okay, we don't have to worry about making it in and we can, you know, try to look for seeding games now.
I love this new dynamic this season to, you know, to have to, you know, worry about, all right, hey, we've got to get it over the line. We got to make a, you know, we got to make a push for the playoffs.
Yeah, yeah. Especially since Uxa's only win was us, so they would have had to head to head. But yeah, so it's fun to get over that line. But we have some fun segments for you guys.
Yes, sir. Because
Kareem is back. So let's get to them right now. All right, guys, let's take a quick break in the podcast to thank and give a shout out to our sponsor, Keep Insurance. And today we have the differences for an index universal life insurance plan versus a 401k. Is a 401k actually better? More people use it. But an IUL plan has guarantees, which the 401k plan does not have, a tax-free retirement, which you have to pay taxes on the 401k, principal protection in the IUL plan, but in the 401k, you have that market loss. There's no age rules, no contribution limits. There is a death benefit, and there are living benefits on a 401k. All of that is the opposite. So think about getting the IUL plan. Contact Tony Koo to customize a plan today. Call or text him for more information at 407-516-2700. Keep your family protected and your legacy alive with Keep Insurance. Okay, so we're here presenting a new segment, new-ish. We've taken inspiration from the Magic, local Magic games. They have a segment called Is This Anything? And Kareem has some stats, some nuggets, some little factoids for us, which he's probably the goat at. And we're gonna react to it and see, hey, does this mean anything or is this just kind of coincidence? You know?
Yes, sir.
So, Kareem, I'll let you have the floor.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So, I took every game that's been played this season, right? That's been 24 total games, right? And I've taken the score, for the winning team and the losing team, obviously. And, you know, we've taken our averages for points for, points against, and average point differential. So this season, average points for is 64.3 points per game. Average points against is 53.7. And this one's interesting. The average point differential is 10.6 points per game. So on average, every game is ending, you know, with a deficit or a margin of, you know, victory of 10.6 points. But, right, we know that there's outliers of blessed winning by 42 points, blessed winning by 30 points.
So I'm like, skewing the numbers.
Right. So let me take out those outliers. And even if you take them out, the average point differential is 8.3 points per game, right? So every win, you know, for the most part, has been kind of comfortable. So looking at the teams that have, won or been in a game of a game that's been decided by 5 or less points, there's only been 7 of those games that have come down to 5 points or less, or have been decided by 5 points or less. So of the 24 games, 7 of them have been decided by 5 or less points. Now, this is interesting. Every team except for Fighters has been involved in at least one game like that. Okay? So it's kind of hard to track, but like, you know, two teams can be in the same game together, right? So that's why at least every one of our teams except for Fighters has been involved in at least one game decided by 5 points or less. Mutaqeen, my team, was involved in 4 of those 7 games.
Okay? Wow. Okay.
All right. And so
more than half the games.
And just to go through everyone's records, in those types of games, Mutaqeen has been 3-1. So of those 4 games, we've won 3 of them. NARS was in 2 of those games and won both of those games. Black Mambas, they were in 2 of those games, but lost 2 of those games. Then you have other teams like Warhoosh. Obviously this past weekend, they just lost at the buzzer. So they lost that one game, but they had a game earlier this season where they won. So they're 1-1. Tawheed, 1-0. Blessed, they lost 1. So Blessed, Aqsa, and Qamar were all in one game, decided by 5 points or less, and they've lost those. So it's interesting, right? It's interesting to judge a team on, hey, if they are in a situation, right, where it is a tight game, you know, how do they fare? How many times have they had to, you know, find themselves in that situation? How have they fared? And does this come to play, you know, in the playoffs? I'd argue that it does, right? So when it comes in the playoffs and it's a close game, we've been there before, right? You know, the nerves of the moment, right, aren't going to be as profound, right, in the playoffs, because it's like, all right, hey, we've been through this. And so I want to hear your thoughts on that before I move to another stat on an indicator of, you know, for win.
Yeah. So actually, let me ask you this, Kareem. That overtime game that you guys just lost, technically you lost by 6.
By 6 points, yeah. Yeah.
So that doesn't even count in the
Exactly. Yeah.
So you really could have 5 games in it, because you had, I mean,
I know.
Technically it's 1st to 5. So I was like, oh, that has to count. No, I was like, wait, they hit 2 threes. So that means you lost by 6.
Yep.
Which means that doesn't count in that game.
Yeah.
But, okay.
That would have given Fighters their first, like, a close game, right?
Close game. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So they want to, I think that I will say that there's merit to that as well. But at the same time, you're 3-1 in 5 points or less games. We're 2-0, so we might be a little biased. If you look at it from the other side of the token, right? Teams that have lost close games, sometimes you can say, hey, it's not just preparation. Sometimes it's just the way the ball bounces, the way a ref calls a foul,
For sure.
If a shot goes in or if it misses, has a big indication on whether that you won that game or you didn't. So those are winnable games that we lost. And for the teams that won, those are losable games that you won. So you can look at it from that side of the token too. But 100%. I think that there is some merit to, hey, you're able to win close games because you're prepared for the moment and having that experience during the regular season. Because the playoffs are going to be close. There's the, you know, the intensity, it ratchets up. So,
yep.
I do think there's some merit to that as well, Kareem. But
for sure.
Go on to your next point.
Okay. All right. So, knowing that the average points for in the win so far this season has been 64 points. So, of the 24 games, let me put it this way. So there was 18 teams this season that have surpassed 64 points or better in a game, right? So there could be games where both teams scored 64 or more, right? So 18 teams have at least had 64 points in a game. 14 of them have ended in wins, and 4 of them have ended in losses. So if you score 64 points in a game, your chances of winning that game so far to this point of the season has been 78%. Your probability of a win is 78% if you score 64 points. It sucks to be, you know, the 4 teams that had lost, having scored 64 points, because your chances were only 22% of losing that game. Now, you know, dropping it down to just, you know, to just 60, say, you know, all right, hey guys, let's just break the 60 point barrier. Where does that put you? So 23 teams have done that. And 16 of them have ended in a win. So if you score 60, if you just break the 60-point barrier, you're 70%. You have a probability of 70% to win that game, right? And and I like to look at that because, you know, for my team, a team that's been struggling offensively, right? I want to go in and say, okay, hey guys, let's try to get to 60. Like I know we're gonna it's gonna be a defensive battle, right? And it's likely gonna be a low scoring game. But generally, if you can get your team to score 60 points, you have a very good chance of winning the game.
Okay. I like that. So 64 is kind of that magic number of almost 80% chance you win that game.
Yep.
And you're looking at 64 is 16 points a quarter. If you really even break it down to that. Mm-hmm. So if you're aiming to get 16 points every quarter, if you have like a 22-point quarter, all right, cool. Now we can then go and score 13, 14 the rest of the quarters and get to that 64 mark. I like that. I know the segment is this anything? That's definitely something. I think that if you aim for 64, and it's not just like, hey, we're just going to cherry pick and play 5-on-4 the whole time.
Yeah.
We'll score 64. Obviously, no. Yeah, against a legit defense, scoring that 64. Gives you a 78% chance. I like that. Okay. Do you think you have to think that that's something, right, Kareem? Obviously, you're diving into the numbers.
For sure. I definitely think it's something. I do see a trend on teams that have, generally been in high scoring games. The comers of the league, the fighters of the league, right? They've been in several games where they've scored 64 more. But at the same time, too, they're allowing 64 more points as well. Right. So those games, there's not really much defense being played there. But the games where, you know, there is defense on both sides, right, you know, or both teams playing defense, there was 8 games. Let me count this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So of the 24 games that were played, 8 games had both teams scoring less than 60 points. And there's a trend there as well with the teams that are in there. So you got the Tawheeds, the Mutaqeens, right? Those guys have had several appearances in those types of games there too. So it also goes to show, hey, if in a low scoring, defensive battle, right? Or just it's just down and dirty with it. Which teams can pull through in a win there? And Tawheed have 2 wins in games like that. Mutaqeen has 2 wins in games like that, and a few others have won.
Okay. I like that. All right. I'm going to try to tell everybody 60 points. That means I got to get more. I got to try to get more looks, get 60, bro. That
there you
means
go.
Every, Hey, 60 points? We got to hit 23s, team. Let's go. That's the blessed model.
That's what Shahab is going to tell him. Come on, bro. Come on and blessed.
Come on and blessed. Yo, that was great, Kareem. I'm glad. I like the little insights, and that's why we have you on, man. But this isn't the only little mini segment that we have before the picks. We also have the NMAA Superlatives. So let's get right to that.
You're listening to the NMAA Podcast. This is your favorite time of the week with your number one podcast.
Okay, and I teased it, and we're here. NMAA Superlatives, in honor of the school year coming back. Obviously, none of us have school anymore, but, you know, we're getting the spirit of things. It's almost fall, right? So we're getting that feeling, that fall feeling. So we have a handful of superlatives. First, we're going to do teams. I have three for what team, Kareem, and then we're going to go to players. So let's go to first, most likely to blow a game in the fourth quarter. Which team do you think would fall into that superlative the most, Kareem?
Oh, thoughts? Man. Oof. I got two teams that come to mind, man. I'm going to go Fighters, and I'm going to go Kamar. Fighters, oh, okay. Because these guys have openly admitted it, right? And, you know, our game on Sunday was, the most recent example, right? They were up 9 points in that fourth quarter. And I don't think we particularly played that well, right? I think Yusuf hit a couple shots, right? And, you know, we forced a couple turnovers and we found ourselves back in the game. That was a game that honestly, we didn't have much going for us at all in that game, but, you know, we found ourselves back into it. So I got Fighters there. And then the Qamar, man, it's just a team that, I don't know. They're just a high octane offense, but a team that's kind of just like reluctant to play defense, right? Like when they want to lock down and play defense, it's almost like out of the ordinary.
Yeah, they're capable, but I haven't seen much of it either. So yeah, I also had Fighter Z for this, but a little, just because of your stat nugget, and this early on in the season, if you had told me this in like week four, I would have said the Mambas, just because they kept getting close in the fourth quarter, and then they would always lose. And just how you said that they're 0-2 in the 5 points or less games, so maybe a little throw in for them, but they've been on such a tear lately that I would not put them in there anymore. I think Fighter Z is one team that, even against Tawheed, they were kind of dominating on offense, then just kind of let off the gas. It was just weird. So they're getting it together though, man. And for them to win and beat you guys in overtime, even like, you didn't unravel this week. So shout out to Fighter Z. Next one I have is most likely to to start a game with four players. And Kareem, I know you're smiling because me and you have the same answer. Kareem, what's the answer that you're thinking of?
Shahab's Al-Qamar, bro.
Yes, come on now. 100%. Al-Qamar is 100% most likely to start with four players. And I don't know why. It's like, it's the games that Shahab doesn't come to either. He's like, oh, I'm out of town, man, for work.
I don't get it. Like, how does it follow him? How does it, like, you know, it's not just like this season, right, that Al-Qamar gets this. It's Al-Qamar every season.
And yeah.
Because it probably has something to do with the fact that, you know, Shahab drafts the same team every season or the same guy every season. But what sucks, right, is that it's usually his, you know, his most important players that are showing up late. You know, Nick Tui, when does he come to a game on time? And if it's an early game, all right, he's going to show up in the second quarter. Amin showed up late a couple times. Like these are his, you know, most important players. So it's frustrating for Shahab here, man. So yeah, this one's easy.
Yeah, I thought that one that one I got immediately. The next one I have four teams, and the last one is most likely to have someone be fouled out/ ejected. Oof. So most likely to get kicked out of the game because the refs called one too many on you. Kareem, you got one in mind?
Yeah, man. This one came quickly too. I got to go blessed. I got to go blessed, man. You've got some prime suspects in there. You know, the Waaris BG incident earlier this season. Amir, if you get him pissed off enough, right, he'll take a whack at you. He might even kick the ball at you, right?
Yeah.
Exactly. Even Muhammad Sayed, man, like, you know, he's such a good defender, but, you know, oftentimes, like, he's going to reach when sometimes he doesn't need to reach in, right? And they're going to call a foul, and he'll get frustrated with it. He might
foul
technical
out
or something, but they got a few suspects on their team.
Yeah, they got a few. So that was the first team that came to my mind as well. And it was a lot for ejected. I was thinking Amir as well. That's the funny part. But for fouled out, I was definitely thinking El Sayed or El Shaari, because these guys play physical defense, man. Hamza too. You can throw Hamza in there. And most likely to get ejected, definitely Ramsey. Screaming his head off on the sideline.
You think so, man? You think Ramsey would get it? Man, I feel like that would, if Ozzie wasn't the commissioner, do you think he takes that?
Oh, Black Mambas, honestly, hold on. Since we're doing the foul out thing, they have like three players on their team that just play such physical defense. I could see a ref that's there boys that's calling ticky-tack calls that would just boom, 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 boom. That's six on you. Get out of here.
Yep.
But yeah, Ozzie screams at his own team like that, so the refs probably don't take it, take offense to it. They're like, oh, he's yelling at his own guys like
that's,
that.
That's
so
true. That's true.
He's yelling at.
I haven't really seen Ozzie, you know, give it to the refs.
I see Kareem, you're a sleeper. You're a dark horse to get thrown out too. I see you get mad sometimes.
Yeah,
man,
if I start seeing red, yeah, I might. Ozzie might literally, like, you know, suspend him for the rest of the
chairs
season.
Might be flying.
Exactly. Like, UCF property may be damaged.
Oh, man. We've seen that before, too. So, but the next one we have is, so yeah, we've got a lot of negative ones. So let's do a positive one. Most likely to single-handedly lead a comeback. And this is a player one, not just a team one. I have a kind of a guy in mind, and it's not one of the usual suspects. Obviously, you could be like, oh, BG, oh, Marcus Ford, with these guys that get buckets and bunches, right? I got one for you that's you've seen it yourself.
I know where you're going with this one, man.
Yusuf Khan.
Oh, come on. Oh, I thought you were going to go Areeb.
Areeb too. But Yusuf Khan.
Yes.
Has. I like just even this fourth quarter, if this man it goes 0-for-5, goes 3-for-3, then goes 0-for-4. He has no middle ground. It's swish.
It's all in or all out.
All in or all out.
Yep.
So if that bunch comes in the fourth quarter, Areeb is a good one too. I should have seen that one. But this man hit 2 or 3 threes in a row, and if that happens to be the fourth quarter, he can single-handedly lead that comeback. So
yeah, that's
a little sleeper one for
that's,
you.
That's Kareem, a good one, man. He definitely did it in week one against Mambas, and then you know, this past Sunday, you know, I think he had 3 threes in the fourth quarter, you know, late in the game, that got us back in the game against Fighters. So that's a good one, man. I thought you were going with Areeb there because of what he did to us,
yeah,
man, 2 weeks prior. I was just like, man, single-handedly, this guy is just bringing them in. And I've seen him do it, you know, time after time too. So Areeb is, you know, my pick. Probably DJ Tony too, man.
That's a good one.
I mean,
buckets,
you know,
and
back
bunches.
To back, like bang, bang, bang. You know, back to back to back threes, and yeah, he can hurt you quick.
Yeah, 100%. Next one I have is most likely to talk trash, and there's a little tandem one with the after this, but most likely to talk trash. Kareem, do you have anybody in mind for this?
Oof, man. I mean, I feel like by default I gotta go Ozzie, right? And I love when he trash talks, man.
Ozzie gets fired up.
That's just vintage Ozzie, man. I love seeing that. By default I go Ozzie. Man,
lot of nice guys in this league, to be fair.
I know, there is. There is. Let me throw this one over to you, man, while I think about this one.
Okay, got you. Think about it. Think about it for a second. I have a couple. The first one that comes to mind for me is some kind of obvious one. I got an obvious one and then a sleeper one. The obvious one is Amir likes to talk trash to certain guys, right? And he'll talk trash to his own team. But Amir has like hit a three in my face once in a while and been like, rat. And I'm like, all right, cool. You know? So another one that's a sleeper that I feel like people don't really talk about.
I just got one too. Oh my
God. Go ahead, Kareem.
I think you're going to go with this. Well, you finish your thought. I think you're going on the same guy.
Nader.
Oh, damn.
Will randomly just get really upset or really hyped up and chirp at you. It's little chirps, Nader. I've seen it happen. And he's one guy that's kind of a sleeper for that.
So, oh, dang. Kareem, that's got to be a sleeper pick. I haven't personally seen that one, but I feel like I could see that sometimes in some video clips.
Yeah.
I'm just like, there's something going on there.
Yeah. Yeah. But who you got, Kareem?
So the guy that I had come to mind was Abud Abdurrahman, Amir's cousin.
Oh.
Dude. This guy. I mean, he might be the number one guy.
Yeah, he might be real.
Whether he's playing or whether he's on the bench, or even if he's not playing you, even if he's not on the team, he's just in the bleachers just talking smack, man. I believe this guy is something else.
He's hilarious.
It's so funny.
He's great. I love him, bro. The next one we have that's tied up to that is most likely to turn up after the trash talk, after being talked trash to. So there's a couple guys that's kind of obvious, but some people take it real personal. You know what I mean? Some people get real upset that they're like, why are you talking to me like this? You know? And I got a sleeper one for you too, because this is just, I guess my theme is just sleeper ones that you wouldn't think about. Amin Hafez, I was talking a little bit of trash to him, and I was like, oh, you hitting all those threes because you don't want to come in the paint, right? And that's me trying to get in his head, trying to get him to stop shooting threes. But he said, you can't come guard me out here. This is automatic. And I was like, what? Wait, I never see you talk like this. Amin, what is going on? Right? So Amin will get hyped, and he's like, I'm slashing on you. I'm like, all right, cool.
That's interesting, man. I feel like you got to go TK. You got to go Tony. Right, if you ever talk crap to Tony, I don't think he's not gonna take that. He's gonna spit it right back at you, and then he's gonna want to get the ball. He's gonna want to, show you up.
Yeah,
I can see Tony being one for sure.
Yeah, that's happened. That happened in our game where I was like, "Yo, this is my paint, blah blah," and then he kind of was after I subbed out, hit a couple shots, but he kind of won him that game against us, so that was really in the season. But that makes sense.
I will say that trash talk gets me going like no other, too, man.
If I'm
getting it, like it almost goes like overboard, almost where I'm like I'm too heated.
Yeah,
but I'm just like, all right, no, like I'm not even thinking. I'm shooting this one from freaking 30 feet out. Last season during our playoffs, right, against you guys, me and Richard Branch kind of got into it a little bit, and
splashing. That's what happened. I didn't even know that.
Yeah, man.
Kareem like four threes in a quarter. I'm like, what is going on, man? Somebody go guard him.
Yep. yeah, man. It's funny, like you wouldn't think that, like, yeah, you know, like, no, it's just that, you know, I'm you know, this is my equilibrium, man. You know, you can't you know, push me, you know, one way or the other. Yeah. But now for me, man, I didn't think I was like that until, you know, these past few seasons.
I love that. Next one we have, like, kind of like a high school yearbook superlative. Best dressed. Now some people come out and they're just like sweatpants. No accessories, no, you know what I mean? Hair is all over the place. Just wore like 10-year-old shoes. Doesn't matter to them. Some people come out and it's a fashion show.
Yes, sir.
You know what I mean? They'll come out, they got the sleeve, they got the fresh kicks, they got. So who comes in mind to you, Kareem, when you're like, the freshest player on the court.
Dang, man. When it comes to shoe game, Tarik is undefeated. So like every season, like he'll have like three shoes, new shoes, right? Like his rotations, it's not even a rotation. It's just new shoe after new shoe.
It's just new shoes. Yeah, yeah.
Whether it's the KDs, he had the AEs recently.
Yeah, the Edwards. Yeah, those are nice.
Kobe's. Like he's always sporting, you know, new kicks. T-Max, I think a few seasons ago too. So when it comes to kicks, definitely taught it.
Yeah, yeah, I can see that. I got one for you. That's making sure his accessories are on correctly, making sure that his bandana looks straight, his pants are tucked into his sock. Derek Dangerfield. This man comes out like it's a Yeezy fashion show, and make sure that everyone sees. Sometimes he'll get like the ripped shirt. I don't know what he's on, bro, but dude, he comes out. He's looking fresh, dude.
It's funny, man. I question sometimes, like, yo, man, how do you play in those sweatpants, man? You're just like, I know. Playing, like, isn't that uncomfortable? But like, no, he can pull it off. He can pull. Like, there's some other players that play in sweatpants where it's like, I don't know about that, but Derek, he does it. Like, all right, it works.
And it's like not even just sweat. It's like the MC Hammer, like, you know what I mean? Like, yeah, those big pants, and I'm throwing it back. Nobody knows. I don't know if people are going to know about this. But the big parachute pants, where it's just like, I'm like, dude, you're going to drill between your legs, and the ball's going to get stuck on the way
It's funny, man. He's got his bandana. He's got nice shoe game, too. He's got the new James Hardens, too. So I pay attention to that kind of stuff. So he's got shoe game.
Yeah,
sure. Another one for me is Christian Solis, right, with his headbands, right, his hairdo, right? No, he's wearing the arm sleeves, right? He's got the, you know, he's got the compression pants on.
Yeah, yeah.
He's like a my player in NBA 2K. Him and Eli.
He's got the 2K my player look. For sure. I like that. He's definitely on there as well. But the last one we have, we got to end it on a funny note. And I, you know what? For some reason, I haven't even told you yet, but I think you're going to think of the same guy I'm saying. Most likely to accidentally hit the glass and make a three. there's a couple of candidates in my mind. But Kareem, is there one that sticks out to you?
Oh, yeah, right away, man. This is another easy one for me. This is Ahmed Kassem.
Yo, that's who I thought of immediately.
Immediately, Ahmed Kassem, man. He hit a bank three for me in the finals. The season that I won it with Tarik and Chris Ross, a big three. It was like 53-15 in the fourth quarter against Tawheed. And he hit this big bank three to put us up six. And then in our game against Wuhoosh 2 weeks ago, he hit a bank three that bounced on the rim like five or six times before falling in.
Yeah.
that one hurt us, man. So this one's Ahmed Kassem for sure.
Yeah, yeah. He hit one, and he hit, I think, last season against NARS. He hit three threes, and I believe one of them, at least one of them, hit off the glass and in. So, yeah, he's definitely on there. That's immediately who I thought of. I don't know if I can think of a better one, but in my head, just because of this, the way this guy shoots, he might shoot it on purpose off the glass. I would say Chris Roman is capable, for some reason, there's something with his jump shot that doesn't make me think swish. It makes me think like a Tim Duncan, like he kisses it off the glass. And I don't even know if he's meaning that. but for some reason, I think of him shooting and I think of him hitting the window when it goes in. So, I mean, I don't know. It might be on accident. It might be on purpose.
I see that one too.
But that is all we have.
I got another one for you real quick.
Oh,
Who's the most likely to pump fake?
Most likely to pump fake? I mean, I feel like Derek Dangerfield's on there too, bro. I feel like Derek's got to be on there too.
It's got to be. Yeah, Derek, man. I thought that was going to be a quick one for you, man.
Because he'll throw his whole body in the fake.
His pump fake is so good.
Yeah.
whether it's a pump fake like on a jump shot, right? Like he'll catch it, you know, he's going to pump fake shooting a three. And then, you know, if you bite it, he's going to take you to the hoop. And then he'll stop right at the hoop, pump fake you there.
Pump fake again. Yeah.
So, yeah, Derek. For me, man. Mobeen's another he's another classic. Mobeen, he's got a his
pump I don't fake. Think Mobeen's even a pump fake. He's actually shooting and then changes his mind.
Changes his mind.
Because Mobeen, I have Mobeen, me and Mobeen were on the same team last season. He's going and he's shooting and he's like, oh, actually, this is contested. And he'll just stop and just dribble out.
It's like the NBA 2K, like when you're about to shoot, but then you can cancel your shot.
Like, oh, no, hit pass. Yeah, yeah, 100%. Mobeen just changes his mind. He's that's not even hilarious. Trying to get them in the air. The defender will jump and fly across him. And he's just like, oh, got him past him. That's a good one. I like Mobeen. Mobeen's a good one. But that's all we have for the anime superlatives. What just happened there? And let's get to the picks.
You're listening to the NMAA Podcast. Your favorite podcast is here.
Okay, everyone, that was the NMAA Superlatives. I do know how to pronounce it, I swear. We are here in the picks segment. We're starting to do a little bit better as a group, Kareem, but it's still not great. The first game we have this week is Zaheer versus Blessed. On Ozzy's power rankings that he put up on the NMAA Instagram, NMAA Basketball, he had Blessed 1 and Zaheer number 2. Dang. So, in Ozzy's rankings, the top two teams in the league facing off, Zaheer coming off a good bounce back wing, Blessed coming off a bye week and then throttling Al-Aqsa. I'm going to kick it to you first, man. Who you got in this game?
Ooh. I want to do stats for this game, man. I want to watch this game.
Yeah.
Zaheer's coming off of a bye week, right? And that could be a good or a bad thing, right? It really depends on the team, right? Like, are they really hungry to get back out there? I think they left on a win, on a good win. Mm-hmm. And Bless is obviously coming off of a freaking disgusting blowout.
Yeah.
You know, Amir versus Debo is going to be a good matchup. I think both are going to have to try hard on defense against one another. And I think Tariq could have a good game. If they're gonna put Muhammad Sayed on Tariq, that would probably be the move to make, because Tariq is gonna be their most dangerous player. So Tariq and Debo both need to have, and Amir put out this stat that, you know, Tariq,
which has been true so far,
yeah. Tariq and one of Debo or Christian have to score like 20 plus points. And do we see that happening in this game? That's three players, right? So Debo, Christian, and Tariq. I could see two of those three getting close to 20. I'm gonna lean Zaheer here, right? Yeah. My gut tells me Bless is gonna win this game, but I could see how Zaheer wins it.
Mm-hmm.
Right? If all three of them have good games, right? Like, obviously two of the three need to have close to 20 points for them to win. That's, you know, historically that's what we've seen so far.
Yeah.
But what if all three of them have good games? It could happen here, man. They just Zaheer, they've proved that they can play defense. Right. They can hold teams to, you know, they've been in low scoring games. You know, we just talked about it in our previous segment. And so with Bless, like, if you really intentionally get out there and really try to slow these guys down and make it a game, you know, in the 50s, I could see Zaheer pulling through. So I'm going to go Zaheer on this game here.
I got you. Okay. So for me, and you're right, the big three all has to play well. For me, and this guy has stepped up big time, it's Zaheer, who is almost at 10 points a game, and he's not just distributing and getting other guys involved. He's actually scoring himself. And for me, Abdel has to come out and hit at least two or three threes to be that factor, so they can't play off of him. Zaheer has to be a scoring threat. and that big three has to play well. And so he definitely has a formula to win. But since there's so many things that are needed, and Bless has just been on a roll, and I don't think that there's so much on a roll that they're not like, they don't think their farts don't stink. You know what I mean? Like they think like, all right, Ramsey, I know Ramsey, he's kind of crazy because he'll be like, ah, I don't know how I'm feeling about this game, bro. I'm like, dude, they have four. You know what I mean? You're fine. And he's like, sometimes playing four is harder than playing five. This is an actual true statement he told me. Sometimes playing four is harder than playing five people are. So I'm like, what? Right? This literally, no. And he's like, I'm telling you, it's a mentality thing. Like, I'm telling. So I know that they're going to come prepared because they're well coached. And they've just been on such a tear. It's hard for me to think that that Zaheer formula will happen. I think that Zaheer is capable of winning this game, though, but I'm going to pick Blessed here. Yeah, I'm going to pick them in a close-ish matchup, probably like a, I'll do the 60 thing, 64 to 58 type game, where Bless pulls out the victory. But yeah, it's going to be a good one. I'm actually excited for that one for sure.
Yeah, I was going to say, if any team is going to score 60 or more, you know, that team is likely going to be Blessed. And if they manage to do so, I think they're going to win the game. The way Zaheer needs to win that game is if they can hold them to under 60, I can see that going Zaheer's way.
Yeah, for sure. For this next game, we have Kareem, yeah, I see you in the corner over here, bro.
Fighter That's my first Z championship, versus, baby.
Fighter Z versus Al Aqsa. I mean, we technically have to pick this game, Kareem. I think I may have an inkling of where you might be leaning here. Because I'm leaning heavily towards one direction. And that one direction is not Zayn Malik or Harry Styles. It's Fighter Z. I think Fighter Z wins this game, and I think they win it pretty, pretty convincingly. I think they probably pull out something like a 70 to 54 type game, and they coast to the end, and they don't come back. Alexa doesn't come back like we said in the superlatives, but Kareem, who you got in this game?
Yeah, it's got to be Fighters for me, Waaris. I can see them going over 70 points too. We see the firepower that they have. And Q is such a man. He's such a good point guard, man. I think he is the best true point guard that we have in this league. And if he's not on that team, I don't think they're as dangerous as they are. You know, his ability to find Harris and Tony when the defense just falls asleep for a second, he's finding them. And these guys do some off-ball screens, right, where there's no way you're running around like these off-ball screens, you know, around Chris Roman, and Q's finding them, right, and they're getting easy points. So, like, they just offensively, they just got a lot of firepower. They play smart. Threats outside the perimeter, and obviously Chris Roman attacking the rim. Just too much to stop there. And Aqsa, I don't know how you recover after that loss last week.
Yeah, they need a bounce back. They needed a better bounce back matchup. Fighter yeah. Z, I don't think is that. Next game, Kareem, you cannot pick, but I'll have you talk about it a little bit. Mutaqeen versus Al Qamar. Al Qamar coming off the loss where they allowed Fellow to go Wilt Chamberlain on them, and you guys are coming off that OT loss, so both teams have trying to bounce back. Kareem, talk to me about this game a little bit.
Oh,
stark difference in approach, by the way. One team has 53 points scored and 53 points against. Another team has 64 points scored, 70 points against. So,
yeah.
Something's got to give
in this game, man. I was just trying to look at, like, what was their lowest scoring game this season. It looks like 57 was their lowest scoring. So they lost to Black Mamba 65-57. That's the only way I think my team can beat Qamar, right, is as we've done to a lot of teams, right, we just, you know, take them to the deep end, right, and make it a very low scoring game.
Yeah.
And just try to drown them out. Like, just choke them out offensively. Right. Because if not, if it's going to be a shootout, we can't keep up with them. I mean, we're just not a good offensive team. We just don't have that firepower. We haven't figured it out yet. So that's got to be the ticket there. Slow them down. But how do you do that? You know, they're going to destroy a 2-3 zone. I've seen them destroy a 3-2 zone. You go man, it's tough to match up against guys like Nick and guys like Amin. If you get Isaiah going, it's tough. And obviously you got Derek there too, who's just been consistent. So this is a dangerous team. Ozzy was talking about it on the last pod, man. This is a dangerous team. I don't think their record really tells how dangerous they are. I'm not looking forward to playing them, but I'll come up with a game plan.
Yeah, I think Amin is really the one piece that really makes their team kind of click, like in perfection, and how that gives them that ceiling for that scoring game. It's unfortunate that he wasn't there this past week against the Mambas, and I think that did make a difference. But then again, Eli was out for the first half of that game, so
yep.
I would have liked to see both teams have all eight for the whole game. But Amin being there, and not even just the scoring, I think what Amin does is kind of like a version of what I do, where he's kind of at the top of the key and he orchestrates and gets his assist that way, and kind of identifies the mismatch and makes sure that they get a good look out of it. Because when we played them and he was doing that and then also sniping from deep, and it was like, oh my God, he's standing so far away. Like, for he makes it 4-on-4, and his 4, because you're putting your best defender on Amin, most likely,
mm-hmm.
your 4 that are playing defense aren't as good as their 4 that are playing offense.
Yeah.
Most of the time. They're going to have a mismatch. So, you can, like you said, can't play zone, can't play 2-3, can't play 3-2. If they get going, you just got to – sometimes you just got to hope that they just miss shots.
They just miss, yeah.
Yep. But if they get going, especially if Isaiah gets going, it's tough.
Tough team,
for sure. At the same time, I do think that, Kareem, there's something to be said about a defensive team coming in and punching somebody in the face. I think the first quarter will indicate to me who's going to win this game. If the first quarter even ends with Mutaqeen scoring 18, 19 points, but Kummer has 20, 21, I think that that has the capability to get ugly.
Yeah.
If I see 11 to 10, 12 to 10, I'm like, okay, Mutaqeen's doing their thing. They came out, they came strong. So I think it's going to be decided pretty early, but I will go Mutaqeen. And I'm going to go Mutaqeen in that low scoring battle. I think that you guys could do it. And I think that you guys can control the glass, because fellow 26 rebounds is, I mean, Byron's not fellow in terms of the glass, but
yep.
Byron gets a lot of offensive rebounds. He gets a lot of opportunities.
Yeah. He rebounds well for his size.
Let's not say 15 offensive rebounds, but let's say he gets 5 or 6. That's a big difference in the game. So I'm going to go Mutaqeen there. And the last game we have of the week, since we have a bye, can the Black Mambas keep their winning streak alive? At first, we were asked, can they keep losing this much? Now, we're asking, can they keep winning this much? Black Mambas versus Wahoosh. Wahoosh still can't get over how cool the logo is. Shout out to whoever made
so
that.
Dope. I forgot.
Black Mambas 3-0. Emma Fellow, 17 and a half points and 75 rebounds a game. It doesn't say. I don't know how many rebounds he's getting. Wahoosh with Arib, who's been going off. Carlos Roman is hopefully healthy. Sharif showed me something this last week. Alex is a solid big. I think this is another heavyweight battle, man. Obi gets his guys prepared to fight and to play physical. And to make sure, you know, you go in, you jump in for the charge. As the coach, when you go in, I mean, Obi probably leads NMA history in charges taken, because he's just been doing it for so long. He took one against us, too, on Marcus. It was a flop. The refs need to see when it's a flop.
Charge.
It was a good defense. It was great defense, actually. but when you set the tone like that as the coach, that reverberates down to your whole team, trickles down to everybody. I think if Carlos is healthy, I really do want to see him healthy. He kind of checked out against us, hit three threes on us, and was coming forcing me to come out and play defense at the top. He needs to be healthy for them to beat the Black Mambas. I think Obi will put himself on Fellow and box him out. I don't know if that's 100% sure to work. I think Fellow has just been on such a tear, and he's been so in the zone in terms of getting the rebounds and putting the putbacks and the finishes. It's hard to see the Black Mambas losing, but Kareem, I'll kick it to you first. I'm still kind of thinking about it. Who you got in this game?
Yeah, this is a game I see Black Mambas winning. Just because Wahoosh is coming in banged up, it sucks, man. Carlos doesn't look well. Beta's, you know, playing on one foot essentially, and it's tough, man. Like, and those are two big time, you know, players for them. I look at, you know, their ability to Mamba's ability to lock down and play defense. Is gonna matter in this game. You gotta slow down Areeb. And if you slow down Areeb, you know, who else is really gonna hurt you? So we were talking about how Sharif looked good, and I agree, he did look good, and he's played aggressive. But you know, for them to win this game, Areeb's gonna have to have a typical Areeb game, but Sharif is gonna have to have a big game, right? A big game, as in like, you know, 17 points or more. And then Alex McCord has got to match, right? Fellow and Gindi. In some way. So he's got to get out there, you know, play with their same level, you know, with the same motor. And that's not to say that he doesn't do that. Alex is kind of like cut, you know, from the same cloth, right? He's always going to attack the boards, offensive boards, defensive boards, but he's got to be a beast out there too. Like, he's got a 12 points, 13 rebounds type of game at a minimum if they want to win that game. So a lot needs to go right for Wahoosh to win this game and for them to go in not fully healthy. I don't like their chances. So I'm going to go Black Mambas on this one. They're figuring things out. They're in, you know, they're in a groove now. And Fellow is just taking the league by storm right now.
Yeah. I think you're right. After, you know, you kind of talked me into it, especially the health thing and the way Ahmed Fellow is playing right now. It's hard to be like, oh yeah, the guy's gotten 20 and 20 every week. I'm going to pick. No, bro. You can't pick the other team. You know, even if all else fails, they have a break classification emergency, Fellow offensive rebound. Let's reset. Like, literally, like, he'll just go get it. And they're like, all right, try again. And there was Ozzy was screaming at them, pick and roll, Eli Fellow. Everybody get out the way.
Yeah.
And he kept doing that. And he's like, do it until it doesn't work. Yeah. He kept screaming, do it until... And what would happen is sometimes Eli would go up and he'd miss, but Fellow was rolling all by himself. He just grabbed the rebound, throw it to Eli, they'd go and try again. Like, it was practice. So
Yeah.
That factor is so difficult to stop. Even against us, like, they probably shot like 31% from the field, but they had so many second chance opportunities that it doesn't matter if they shoot bad. We'll have enough opportunities that we're going to win. So I'm going to go Black Mambas here and pick them to win four in a row. If Ozzy can go 11 losses straight and then go 11 wins straight, could you imagine? That would be insane.
That'd be a story.
Huge story. So that is all we have for the picks. Kareem, thank you for making your season debut. I hope that this isn't the last podcast you're on this season. It is the first, but hopefully it's not the last.
Hopefully not, man. Hopefully not. This was fun.
This is a good time. But to all the listeners, thank you for tuning in. Thank you for watching. Leave us a like and subscribe. I don't even ask you to do that because it sounds cringy to me. I just hope that you just think to do it naturally. It does help us, though. Leave a review. We appreciate you. Thank you for listening. Everybody be happy. Everybody be healthy. We'll be back with you next week.
Oh, rock.
Peace out, guys. Element.
We are NMAA. Basketball Dean Brotherhood.
We've got former college D1 athletes, former international players, competition at all levels. Come on, man, is what we do best.
It's game time, grab your crew cause I got mine. Cause my five, we gon' shut her down like prime time. We always ready, staying steady on these front lines. Lights, camera, action, and we live, call it showtime. This labor of love, we call it grind and dedication. Blood, sweat, and tears for years, call it determination. Don't get it mistaken with people hating on your greatness. We just patiently waiting to make a slam dunk statement. So turn the station to NMAA Podcast. Got the commission on, going full blast. So when they ask who's the greatest in the state, well, we're shaking bacon and breaking ankles and soul weight. I'm too clean and precise with my jump shot. Celebrate with my bow and arrow, call it guns hot. Locked and loaded with my bag and my whole squad. Always rolling deep with my team, praising one God. Alhamdulillah.
Did you give it all you got? Did you give it 110%? Any team's capable of holding that championship trophy. Just depends how bad you want it.
I'm ruthless, I'm competitive. My drive's on fire, I'm so tentative. I dominate, call me executive. I'm a champion.
Let's go!
In the race of life, could have never reached the finish line. I'ma get what's mine, gonna do the time, cause I'm in my prime. My mind is my weapon, my mental toughness is dead on. I'm a sharpshooter. I'm a champion.
It's not over till I say it is. Body still working hard, beating blessed, time to live. It's all or nothing, I got all to give. Pushing to the last second, cause it's still time to win. Never too late, cause I'm the champion within. And the champions are made of perseverance. No quitting, no quitting, ha, yeah. That's why I'm out here grinding day and night, day and night. Always hungry, staying humble, that's my way of life. Cause every team dreams of being the number one seed. But do you got what it takes to make it in this league? Giving it all, gave him a line, going 110. Claiming it all, looking to thrive, decisions always a win.
I'm ruthless, I'm competitive. My drive's on fire, I'm so tentative. I dominate, call me executive. I'm a champion.
Let's go!
In the race of life, quitters never reach the finish line. I'ma get what's mine, gonna do the time, cause I'm in my prime. I dominate, call me executive. I'm a champion.